This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Nedra. Author, George Barr McCutcheon. Chapter 1, The Inspiration. A tall young man sped swiftly up the wide stone steps leading to the doorway of a mansion in one of Chicago's most fashionable avenues. After pushing the button sharply, he jerked out his watch and guessed at the time by the dull red light from the panel in the door. Then he hastily brushed from the sleeve of his coat the telltale billiard chalk, whose presence reminded him that a general survey might be a wise precaution. He was rubbing a white streak from his trousers' leg when the door flew open and the butler admitted him to the hallway. This personage relieved him of his hat, coat, and stick and announced, "Miss Vernon is waiting for you, sir." "How the devil did I happen to let 8 o'clock strike 9 before I knew it?" muttered the visitor. He was at the drawing-room door as he concluded this self-addressed reproach, extending both hands toward the young woman who came from the fireplace to meet him. "How late you are, Hugh," she cried half-resentfully. He bent forward and kissed her. "Late? It isn't late, dear. I said I couldn't come before 8, didn't I? Well, it's 8, isn't it?" "It's nearly 8:70, sir. I've been waiting and watching the hands on the clock for just 60 minutes. I never saw such a perfect crank about keeping time as that grandfatherly clock of yours. It hasn't skipped a second in 2 centuries, I'll swear. You see, I was playing off the odd game with Tom Ditton." He dropped lazily into a big armchair, drove his hands into his pockets and stretched out his long legs toward the grate. "You might have come at 8, Hugh, on this night, if no other. You knew what important things we have to consider." Miss Vernon, tall and graceful, stood before him with her back to the fire. She was exceedingly pretty, this girl whom Hugh had kissed. "I'm awfully sorry, Grace, but you know how it is when a fellow's in a close, hard game, especially with a blowhard like Tom Ditton. If I forgive you again, I'm afraid you'll prove a begging husband." "Never. Deliver me from a begging husband. I shall assert all kinds of authority in my house, Miss Vernon, and you'll be in a constant state of beggary yourself. You'll have to beg me to get up in the morning, beg me to come home early every night, beg me to swear off divers things, beg me to go to church, beg me to buy new hats for you, beg me to eat things you cook, beg me to. I suppose I shall even have to beg you to kiss me," she cried. "Not at all. That is one thing I'll beg of you. Lean over here, do, and kiss me, please," he said invitingly. She placed a hand on each arm of the chair and leaned forward obediently. Their lips met in a smile. "You lazy thing," she exclaimed, her face slightly flushed. Then she seated herself on one of the big arms, resting her elbow on the back of the chair beside his head. For a few minutes both were silent, gazing at the bright coals before them, the smile remaining upon their lips. Hugh had been squinting between the toes of his shoes at a lonely black chunk in the grate for some time before he finally spoke reflectively. "I can't afford to be lazy much longer, can I? Married men never have a minute's rest, you know." "We're not married." "No, but we're going to be, let me remind you. We are to announce it tomorrow night, are we not? It has come to that, you see." He did not look very cheerful, nor did she. "Yes, I suppose it's imperative. That is why Aunt is giving her reception, just to tell everybody we're engaged. And then everybody will shake hands with us and say, 'Congratulations, how lovely, so surprised, howdy do,' and so forth, and we say, 'Thanks, how good of you,' and more so forth. It will be great." Another silence and inspection of the fire, he taking an altered aim at the black chunk. "Say," he exclaimed, "wouldn't it do just as well if I didn't put in an appearance tomorrow night? Your aunt can announce the thing as agreed, and you can tell him that I have a sick uncle in Indianapolis, or have had my leg broken, or something like that. Now there's a good girl." "No," she said. "We fell in love because we couldn't help it, and this is the penalty, an announcement party." "I'll never quite understand why you fell," said he dubiously. I think we were both too young to know, she responded. It seems to me that we've been in love ever since we were babies. And it never hurts a baby to fall, you know, said he with fine logic. Of course it may cripple him permanently, but they don't know how it happened. For some moments, she caressed his brown hair in silence, the smile lingering on her lips after it had left her eyes. His eyes closed dreamily under the gentle touch of her fingers. But dear, she said, this is no joking matter. We have been engaged for nearly 3 months, and not a soul knows of it. We'll have to tell them how we managed to keep it a secret for so long, and why, and all that. And then everybody will want to know who the bridesmaids are to be. I believe I'd like to know that myself, as long as I'm to walk out of the church ahead of them, provided I don't get lost. Helen Grossman is to be the maid of honor. I believe I'll ask Jean Robertson, Eloise Grant, Harriet Noble, Mae McMurtry, Ellen Boyland. Are we to have no guests? And Effa Samuels. Won't it be a pretty set of girls? Couldn't be prettier. And now, who is to be your best man? Well, I thought I'd have Tom Ditton, a trifle confusedly. Tom Ditton. I thought you did not approve of him, she cried. You certainly did not, when he came to see me so frequently. Oh, he isn't such a bad sort, after all. I just as soon have him as anyone. Besides, he's an expert at it. If it was left to me, I'd much rather sit behind the pulpit until it is all over. People won't miss me while they've got you to look at. We could be married so quietly and prettily if it were not for Aunt Elizabeth, pouted Miss Vernon. She insists on the church wedding, the teas and receptions and all that sort of rot, he interjected, as if fearing she might not express herself adequately. I like your Aunt Elizabeth, Grace, but she's an awful. Don't say it, Hugh. I know what you mean, but she can't help it. She lives for society. She's perfectly crazy on the subject. Aunt Elizabeth made up her mind we should be married in church. I have talked myself black in the face for your sake, dear, but it was like trying to convert a stone wall. She is determined. You know what that means. No wonder she's a widow, growled Hugh Ridgway sourly. Your father served you a mighty mean trick, dear, when he gave you over to her training. She might have spoiled you beyond redemption. Poor father. He loathed display too. I've no doubt that is why he left me in her care until I reached the age of discretion. She was not always like this. Father's money has wrought the change. Auntie was as poor as a church mouse until father's death put her at the head of my household. It was mine, Hugh, even if I was only 6 years old. You know we could live pretty well on $40,000 a year. You'll have a million or so when you're 23, dear, and I'll venture to say your aunt has saved something in all these years. Oh, she had at least $200,000 by the will. It has cost her nothing to live all these years as my guardian and trustee. We just had to do something with my income, you know. I don't see why you should let this fortune stand in the way, Grace, growled he. Haven't I enough of my own to take its place? Hugh Ridgway had a million in his own right, and he could well afford to be unreasonable. The will says, you are not to have your father's money until you are 23 years old. He evidently thought that was a discreet age. You are not to marry before you have reached that age. I've been waiting for 2 years, Grace, and there still remains 2 months. 1 month and 28 days, Hugh, she corrected. And in the meantime, we have to stay here and face all this anti-nuptial wretchedness. It's sickening, Grace. We hate it, both of us. Don't we? I knew you'd nod your head. That's why I can't help loving you. You've got so much real good hard sense about things. If your confounded Aunt Lizzie, Elizabeth I should say, would let us get married as we want, hang it all, Grace, it's our affair anyhow, isn't it? Why should we permit her to dictate? It's not her wedding. She's been married twice, why can't she let well enough alone? She loves me, Hugh, after all, gently. Well, so do I'm willing. Not perfectly willing, of course, but reasonably so, that we should wait until the 23rd of May, but I don't see why we should have the whole town waiting with us. Why don't you assert yourself, dear, before it is too late? Once she pulls off this announcement party, it's all off with peace of mind and contentment so far as we are concerned. Of course she'll be enjoying it, but what of us? Are you afraid of her? Don't bully me, Hugh, she pleaded. He was contrite at once, and properly so. She has lived for this time in her life. She never has been crossed. I can't. Honestly, I can't go to her now and quarrel. That's what it would mean, a quarrel. She would never give in. Well then, all hope is lost, he lamented. For some minutes Miss Vernon gave no response, sitting upon the arm of the chair, a perplexed pucker on her brow and a thoughtful swing to her slippered foot. These young people had known each other since earliest childhood. They had played together with the same neighborly toys, and they had grown up together with the same neighborly ideals. Both had whirled in the social swing until the sensation palled. The most exclusive set in town regarded them as among its most popular members. It was quite natural that their wedding should be the most brilliant and fashionable of the year. Their position in society demanded the sacrifice, and her aunt saw the urgent need for making it, notwithstanding the opposition of the young people themselves. Ridgway was a couple of years older than his affianced bride, and she was just short of 23. She, an orphan since early childhood, lived with her widowed aunt, the social gourmand to quote Hugh Ridgway, and he made his home next door with his sister and her husband. The two brownstone houses were almost within arm's reach of each other. She had painted dainty watercolors for his rooms, and he had thrown thousands of roses from his windows into her boudoir. It had been a merry courtship, the courtship of modern cavalier and lady fair. Ridgway's parents died when he was in college, and he was left to enlarge or despise a fortune that rated him as a millionaire and the best catch in town, at that time. He was a member of the Board of Trade, but he was scarcely an operator in the strictest sense of the word. If he won, he whistled, if he lost, he whistled. It mattered little. Good-looking, well-dressed, generous to a fault, tainted but moderately with scandal, he was a man whom everybody admired, but who admired few in return, a perfectly natural and proper condition if one but stops to consider. Miss Vernon was beautiful. Of that there was no question. Tall, fair, brown-eyed, and full of the life that loves, she ruled the hearts of many and kept her hand for one. Her short gay life had been one of luxury and ease. She had known few of its cares. Its vicissitudes belonged to the charities she supported with loyal persistency. Her aunt, society mad, was her only mentor, her only guide. A path had been made for her, and she saw no other alternative than to travel it as designed. A careless, buoyant heart, full of love and tenderness and warmth, allowed itself to be tossed by all of the emotions, but always sank back safely into the path of duty and rectitude. It was not of sufficient moment to combat her aunt's stubborn authority. It was so much easier to do her own sweet will without conflict, and then smile down on the consequences. Possibly it is true that she did not love her aunt. If that were the case, she kept it well to herself. She could not have been blamed, however, for disliking the dictator. Hugh Ridgway was more or less right when he said that no one in town admired the old lady. She was hard, devoid of humor, wrapped up in her own selfishness, shrewd, capable, and resourceful. Her brother, on his deathbed, signed the instrument which made this arrogant relative the arbiter of the girl's future for many years to come. She was appointed guardian and trustee until legal age was attained, and as such she was absolute in her power. The large fortune was to be held in trust by this aunt, Mrs. Torrance, and the Honorable Stanley Goodland until Grace was 23 years of age. The income from the investments in bonds, real estate, and high-class securities was to be handled by Mrs. Torrance as she saw fit, in the effort to better the young woman's mental and social estate. To do her justice, she performed the duties well and honorably, even though her measure of human nature was not full to overflowing. Grace, with a mind and heart of her own, undertook to cultivate human nature from her own point of view after years of tolerance, and she succeeded so well that her aunt was none the wiser. On one point, however, the paragon was so firm and unassailable that Grace was obliged to confess failure to her lover after weeks and weeks of splendid argument. Her aunt forced an issue. The marriage of her niece was to be brilliant to the verge of confusion, and the ante-nuptial season was to be one which the city should not forget while its promoter lived to enjoy the emoluments. She knew she was making her niece unhappy, but she argued that her niece was too deeply in love to appreciate the value of opportunity. Besides, on her wedding day, Grace Vernon would be 23 years of age, mistress of herself, her fortune, and her husband's home. That day would end the reign of Elizabeth Torrance. The arbiter was determined that the reign should end in a blaze of glory. As for Grace and Hugh, they were to be married. That had been decided upon by destiny years and years ago, and ratified after Hugh had reached an age of discretion. He said that 25 was the year of discretion, if not of reason. After the first transports, each began to consider the importance of the union, not only to themselves but to the world at large. In their reflective moments, they realized that the marriage would be the most wonderful event in the whole history of the homes of Vernon and Ridgway. Never before had a Vernon married a Ridgway, and vice versa. Therefore, the whole world would visit upon such a union its undivided attention. That is the view all engaged people take of marriage. Miss Vernon had employed 6 weeks of argument in convincing Mr. Ridgway that a church wedding was imperative, although she admittedly preferred the simpler form, where the minister conducts the ceremony in the presence of 2 witnesses and a ring. Society demanded the exhibition. Mr. Ridgway warned her that he could not survive the ordeal and would leave her a widow at the altar. Their difficulties had at last resolved themselves into that condition which confronts every engaged pair, and they, like others, were preparing to inform the world of their intentions. "There's no way out of it, Hugh," she finally sighed, "unless we decide to give up the hope of getting married. That would break my heart," she said with her rarest smile. "This would be the most delightful period of my life if it were not for that distressing announcement. The 2 months of purgatory between now and the day of the wedding, and then the calamity. I know it will be a calamity. I can't get through it alive. You poor boy. I wish we could have a quiet little wedding. It would be so sweet, wouldn't it, dear?" she said plaintively, wistfully. "But instead we are to have a hippodrome. Bah," he concluded spitefully. "I wouldn't talk this way, dear, if I didn't know that you feel just as I do about it. But," and here he arose wearily, "this sort of talk isn't helping matters. It's a case of church against choice. Tomorrow night we'll tell 'em, and then we'll quit sleeping for 2 months. There's only one way out of it that I can see. We might elope," she said laughingly, standing before him and rubbing the wrinkles from between his eyes. Gradually, his gray eyes fell until they looked into hers of brown. A mutual thought sprang into the eyes of each, like a flash of light plainly comprehensive. He seized her hands, still staring into her eyes, and an exultant hope leapt to his lips, bursting forth in these words. "By George." "Oh, we couldn't," she whispered, divining his thought. "We can. By all that's good and holy, we'll elope." Hugh's voice was quivering with enthusiasm, his face a picture of relief. "Honestly, do you think we could?" The girl's eyes were wide with excitement, her cheeks burning. "Can we? What's to prevent? Will you do it, Grace, will you?" cried he. "What will everybody say?" "Let 'em say. What do we care? Won't it be the greatest lark that ever happened? You're the smartest woman in the world for thinking of it." "But I wasn't in earnest," she protested. "But you are now, we both are. Listen, we can slip away and get married and nobody will be the wiser, and then, when we come back, we can laugh at everybody. And get our pictures in the papers. Then by hokey, we won't come back for 5 years. How's that? That'll fool 'em, won't it? Say, this is great. Life is worth living after all." You'll go, won't you, Grace? I'd go to the end of the world with you, Hugh, but... Oh, say you'll go. Now listen to this, he urged, leaping to his feet. We're going to be married, anyway. We love one another. You can't be married until the 23rd of May. Lots of people elope, even in the best of families. Why shouldn't we? If we stay here, we'll have to face all the sort of thing we don't like. Yes, but it won't take us 2 months to elope, she protested. Shush. Don't speak above a whisper. Aunt Elizabeth has wonderful ears. By Jove, darling, I believe you're 2/3 willing to try it on, he whispered. We must be sensible, Hugh. You see, I can't be married until the 23rd of May. Well, Aunt is determined to announce the engagement tomorrow night. Don't you see we couldn't elope until the 22nd at best? So we're doomed for 2 months of it in spite of ourselves. If we get through the 2 months, why should we elope at all? The worst will be over. We can't escape the announcement party, I'll admit, but we can get away from all the rest. My scheme is to elope to a place that will require 7 or 8 weeks' time to reach. That's a fine way to kill time, don't you see? My goodness. Why not? We can do as we like, can't we? And what a bully lark. I'd be a downright cad to ask you to do this, Grace, if I didn't love you as I do. We can use assumed names and all that. Oh dear, dear, doesn't it sound lovely? She cried, her cheeks red with excitement. The 23rd of May isn't so far off after all, and it won't be half so far if we're doing something like this. Will you go? If I only could. Do you really think we could? Whoop! He shouted as he seized her in his arms and rained kisses upon her face. Then he held her off and looked into her eyes for a moment. Then he gave another whoop, kissed her, released her, and did a wild dance about the room. She stood beside the big chair, equally as excited, laughing unrestrainedly at his hilarity. At last he brought up at the other side of the chair. But where could, I mean, shall we elope to? She finally asked. Anywhere. Bombay, Australia. Let's make it a stunner, dear, let's do it upright. And be married away over there? Oh, Hugh. Certainly. They can marry us over there, as well as anywhere. Here, I'll write the names of 10 places and we'll draw one from my hat. He sat down before a table and feverishly wrote upon the backs of a number of his calling cards the names of as many cities, his companion looking over his shoulder eagerly. Without ado, he tossed the cards into a jardiniere in lieu of a hat. Draw, he said tragically. Wait a minute, Hugh. What have we to elope from? There isn't the faintest objection in the world to our marriage. There you go, backing out. No, I'm just as willing as you, but doesn't it seem rather absurd? Her hand hung over the jardiniere irresolutely. It will be the greatest wedding tour that mortals ever took. Draw. Well then, there's the card. Mercy, she cried, dropping a card on the table. That's a long distance, Hugh. He picked up the card, and his face paled a little as he read. Manila. They sat down in the chair, she on the arm as before. After a moment he glanced at her perplexed face and asked, Are you afraid to go, Grace? It isn't that, Hugh. I was just wondering if we could reach Manila by the 23rd of May. It is unlucky to change the wedding day after it has been once selected, she said softly. Grace Vernon, you are an angel. I was afraid you would show the white feather. It's a go then, Manila. We can start next week and get there in good time. Next week? Impossible, she cried in alarm. Nonsense. You can get ready for a trip to New York, making your preparations for a sea voyage secretly. I'll attend to all the details. It will be easy. No one will ever dream of what we are doing until we cable the news home to your aunt. Oh, I must tell Aunt Elizabeth. Not much. That's no way to elope. We must do it correctly or not at all. Nobody is to know, until we are really married. Can you get ready in a week? If I really must. Can't take any more time than that if we want to reach Manila in time for the wedding. Oh, Hugh. We can't go to Manila, she cried, suddenly starting to her feet in distress. My Uncle Harry lives there. He is my mother's only brother, and he's been there since the close of the war. He's in the hemp business. Oh dear. How provoking, she concluded almost piteously. It's fine, he exclaimed jubilantly. We can be married, at his home. I'm sure he'll be happy to have us. You can write and tell him we're coming, dear. Lord, with great relief in his voice, that simplifies matters immensely. Now we have an excuse for going to Manila. But above all things, don't cable to him. Write a nice long letter and mail it just before we start. She was silent a long while, staring soberly at the blaze in the grate. There'll be no bridesmaids and ushers over there, Hugh. We don't want 'em. Silence for a few minutes. In a week, did you say? Positively. Well, I'll be ready, she said solemnly. He kissed her tenderly, lovingly, pressed her cold hand and said encouragingly, We'll meet in New York next Monday afternoon. Leave everything to me, dear. It will be much pleasanter to go by way of London, and it will help to kill a good deal of time. Hugh, she said, smiling faintly, I think we're proving that Father was right. I can't possibly arrive at the age of discretion until I am 23 and past. Chapter 2, The Beginning of Flight. Mr. Ridgway paced back and forth outside the iron gates in the Grand Central Station on the afternoon of April 1, 1990, a smile of anticipation and a frown of impatience alternating in his fresh, young face. Certain lines of care seemed to have disappeared since we saw him last, nearly a week ago, and in their stead beamed the light of a newfound interest in life. Now and then he took from his pocket a telegram. Spectators stared amusedly at him as he read and reread. Detroit, Michigan, March 81, 190. To H.B. Ridge. Got away safely. Meet me 42nd Street, New York, tomorrow at 3. Feel awfully queer and look a fright. Sympathetic lady, next compartment, just offered condolences for loss of my husband. What are the probabilities of storm? Be sure and find out before we start. Sister Grace. Isn't that just like a girl? He muttered to himself. Where else would 42nd Street be but New York? London? They had decided to travel as brother and sister, and to adopt Ridge as the surname. Hugh had taken passage for Liverpool on the liner St. Cloud, to sail on the 2nd, having first examined the list of passengers to ascertain if there were any among them who might know him or his companion in the adventure. The list was now complete, and he, assured that there was no danger of recognition, felt the greatest weight of all lifted from his mind. He had also considerately inquired into the state of the weather, and learned that it promised well for the voyage. The whole affair was such a glorious lark, such an original enterprise, that he could scarcely restrain himself in his exhilaration from confiding in his chance hotel acquaintances. Purposely, the night before, he had gone to an hotel where he was unknown, keeping under cover during the day as much as possible. According to the prearranged plan, they were to go aboard ship that evening, as the sailing hour was early in the morning. He was waiting for her train. Every now and then his glance would shoot through the throng of people, somewhat apprehensively, as if he feared instead of hoped that someone might be there. This searching glance was to determine whether there might be any danger of Chicago or New York acquaintances witnessing the arrival of the person for whom he waited. Once he recognized a friend and dodged quickly behind a knot of people, escaping notice. That is why he audibly muttered, Thank heaven! Every nerve was tingling with excitement, an indescribable desire to fly, to shout, to race down the track to meet the train swept through him. His heart almost stopped beating, and he felt that his face was bloodless. For the 20th time in the last 2 hours, Ridgway looked at his watch and frowningly exclaimed, Only 2:05. Nearly an hour to wait. He sat down for a moment, only to arise the next and walk to the board announcing the arrival of trains. Almost immediately, one pulled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.